Good afternoon, everyone. Pleasure to be here. Pleasure to be back home, so to speak, a little bit, having a little bit of a family reunion with Nana. So what I'd like to do today is sort of just share a few thoughts about the book, a few slides, which I hope you'll find a bit comical, and then just jump into our conversation and leave plenty of room for question and answer, which I hope you'll have plenty of. They say every writer is in some ways, right, or every poet at least, or every writer, is always writing the same poem or story over and over again, or one poem all their lives, or one story all their lives. And what that means figuratively, of course, is the idea that each artist is sort of obsessed, has a sort of a singular obsession around which their whole body of work comes to bear on. And the body of work is in some ways an attempt to dimension some part of that obsession, to ask some questions about that obsession, to answer those questions, to ask new questions. And for me, that obsession comes down to one word, home. And it's no wonder, as I like to say, I was made in Cuba, assembled in Spain, and imported to the United States, which meant my mother left 7 months pregnant from Cuba and to Madrid, where I was born, and then 45 days later, we emigrated to the United States, first to New York and eventually to Miami. And as I look back on my life, it was this sort of wonderful sort of foreshadowing of the things that little Ricky would grow up to be obsessed about, these ideas of home and everything that word encompasses, family, cultural identity, place, sort of national loyalties, all these sort of set of questions. That little photo, it's un recordatorio, that little photo I love to show in following that sort of script is my very first newborn photo, which was my green card photo. So by the time I was 45 days old, that was my first ID in the United States. It was also, when I come to think of it, by the time I was 45 days old, I belonged to three countries. I had lived in two world-class cities. So again, it was this, when you look back on your life, it just seems like there was this great script, which continued in moving to Miami, which means I grew up between two imaginary worlds, as I like to describe it. One is the imaginary 1950s and 60s Cuba of my parents, my grandparents, and my community at large. This kind of romantic, nostalgic vision of that place. This place where I was from, where we were from, even though they called me El Galleguito. But this place that we belonged to, but I had never been. And so it felt real and yet completely imaginary. And the other world, growing up in Miami, was the other imaginary world was America, as I think Liz Balmaceda said. No, Nana said, we love living in Miami because it's so close to the United States, and you don't need a passport. So Miami became how I contextualized America, which felt like this other sort of distant country, was of course through television, through commercials, through the G-rated versions of our history, and through food, which is what my first excerpt will be about. But it was really, that's really sort of the obsession of my work. How does one become, how do all these factors figure out into that sense of home and of becoming? And that is certainly the psychological and physical setting of the Prince of Los Cucuyos. One of those other obsessions was the Winn-Dixie that was in Westchester. We lived, there's a suburb of Miami where the book takes place. It's called Westchester, but it's really called in the book Guachete. And it's just sort of an ironic name for a suburb that just became like 99.9% Cuban throughout the 60s and 70s. And one of the last remnants of sort of Anglo-America was the Winn-Dixie, which is where all the Americanos shopped. And it was a place that we all, well, not all of us, but it was a place of my fantasy, but a place of fear and dread for most other Cubans. We always went through to all the little bodeguitas and whatnot. So this is a little excerpt about that fascination from the very first chapter. So little Ricky's here, 7, 8 years old, and that's my grandmother. I just want you to notice her in her best there. And notice how close she's clutching her pocketbook and how I am dreadfully looking away from her. My grandmother is a big character and a big source of frustration and delight as well in the book. So here we go. Every day after Abuela and Abuelo picked me up from school, she'd chase after specials on name brands and daily staples at one of three Cuban bodegas she frequented. Abuelo would pull his lawn chair from the trunk and camp under a palm tree in the parking lot, smoking a cigar and reading a Spanish translation of a dime store Western in the shade while he waited. Abuela would tuck her beaded coin purse in her brassiere, a tip she had picked up from the New York Puerto Ricanas, who had taught her how to guard her cash against would-be muggers. She'd march into the store du jour, bouncing in her crepe-soled orthopedic shoes with me in tow. Some days we went to La Sorpresita, the little surprise, the smallest of the three bodegas. Some days we went to El Gallo de Oro, the golden cock, where the Cuban bread was 10 cents cheaper than any place else. And other days to La Caridad, named after the patroness of Cuba, Our Lady of Charity. The neon virgin with a flashing halo above the canopy was so lifelike that Abuela would insist I make the sign of the cross before going inside. But every single week I'd beg Abuela to go to the Winn-Dixie instead, but she refused to set foot in the place. There's none of our food in El Winn-Dixie. Only los Americanos shop there, Abuela sneered. It's too expensive anyway, she'd complain, dismissing my pleas, until the day she spotted a Winn-Dixie circular in the mail advertising a special too tempting for Abuela to ignore. A whole roasted chicken, its drumsticks crowned with fancy paper hats, and a banner beneath trumpeting its not-so-fancy price, whole fryers, 29 cents per pound. What does whole fryer mean, Abuela asked. Pollo entero, I translated. De verdad, she said incredulously. At La Caridad, I paid 34 cents on a special. I played on her piqued curiosity. Sí, abuela, it's a great price for chicken. Increíble. You sure could save a lot of money. She agreed and left the circular on the kitchen counter instead of tossing it out with the rest of the junk mail that came in English. Few things intimidated abuela. Among these were black magic Santeria and Americanos. As for Americanos, Abuela wouldn't go anywhere she perceived to be wholly American, at least not alone. This included the Social Security office downtown, any restaurant with English-only menus, even Kim's Chinese Palace, fancy department stores like Burdine's, and most definitely not Winn-Dixie. But Abuela also couldn't resist a bargain. The following week, the chicken appeared in the mail at 26 cents per pound, 3 cents cheaper than the week before, and then 24 cents the week after that. The fryers haunted Abuela. Her stinginess slowly overcame her fear of Americanos until finally she broke. Mijo, will you go with me shopping in a Winn-Dixie mañana? She half asked, half commanded. Of course, Abuela, no te preocupes, I'll go with you. Soon, I dreamed our pantry would be stocked with crunch berry cereal and Oreo cookies, our freezer stuffed with Swanson TV dinners and Eskimo pies, our fridge filled with Hawaiian punch and American cheese. The next day after school, Abuela instructed Abuelo to drive to El Winn-Dixie instead of La Caridad. A gigantic red neon sign marked its entrance, the letters spelling out Winn-Dixie, the beef people, seeming to glow even in the daylight. What does the beef people mean? Abuela questioned me. I struggled for a translation that would make sense, but none did. La gente de carne, I finally offered. ¿Cómo? How could that be? Abuela said, perplexed by the thought of people made of meat, which is what my literal translation meant in Spanish. Why not the chicken people or the carne puerco people? She amused herself. Abuela tore the advertisement for the fryer from the flyer and stuffed it into her coin purse, which she then stuffed into her brassiere and kissed Abuela goodbye as if she might not return. Dios nos ampare. God be with us, she muttered. She said nothing until we reached the store entrance. Now take me straight to Los Pollos and no talking to no one. We don't belong here. The electric doors yawned open. I reached for a shopping cart twice as big as the ones at La Caridad, but Abuela tugged me back, saying, don't you dare, with her wide-open eyes, too anxious to speak. I could barely speak myself, not from fear, but from pure awe. I was finally in Winn-Dixie. The air-conditioned air smelled as crisp and clean as Lysol. Each of the 10 checkout lines was numbered with an illuminated sign, and the cashiers all wore pressed polyester uniforms. Instead of warped squares of linoleum, polished terrazzo floors gleamed and soft violin music rained from the speakers in the ceiling. I was finally in America. We stepped into the produce section full of fruits and vegetables I had never eaten or even heard of. Brussels sprouts, squash, tangelos, apricots. Brussels sprouts, squash, tangelos, apricots. I kept pronouncing them in my mind, trying to imagine the taste from the sound of their names. Pretending I was looking for the chickens, I deliberately wove us through every aisle, taking it all in. The cartoon faces on the cereal boxes I'd only seen on TV, the frost-like snow on the freezer cases, flavors of Jell-O I had never knew existed, raspberry, black cherry, lime, soup made from cheddar cheese, from potatoes, broccoli. I wanted to buy and taste everything I saw. But of all the things I had tried at Jimmy Dawson's house, my absolute favorite was easy cheese. And there, in the snack aisle, I saw it. "Can you buy me this, abuela?" I asked, grabbing a can off the shelf. "What's that?" she asked. "It's queso, abuela, queso americano. Please, it's my favorite," I begged. "What? Queso en una lata?" she questioned, unable to fathom the idea of cheese in a can. But I could tell from the tone of her voice that she was intrigued. Look, I said, spraying a dab on my finger and licking it off. "You don't even need to put it in the refrigerator." She looked at me and my finger at me and my finger at the can at me. "Qué cosa? Como inventan los americanos?" She marveled at the ingenuity of Americans. "Let me taste," she asked, holding out her index finger. "Ay, qué rico," she paused, and then questioned, "Pero how much is it?" Taking the can from my hand to look at the price. $1.35. "Bueno, okay, but only if you promise to eat it all. I don't want to be wasting food. But let's get a fresh one, mijo," she said, putting the can back on the shelf and taking a new one. It's funny how that's universal. It's cross-cultural, cross-sexuality, international. You're all guilty of that. That's a magical, some of the magical parts about writing when you sort of dawn upon these moments that you realize you think are so private, and then you realize there's this wonderful element. Anyway, here we are back at the down at the checkout counter after an hour. We plopped down all 10 of our chickens and my easy cheese on the conveyor. The cashier was polite and American, no doubt judging from her name tag, Beatrice, not the Spanish Beatriz. After ringing up two chickens, Beatriz paused. "I'm sorry, are you together?" she asked. "Yes," I answered. "Well, you can only take two chickens on special. I'm sorry." Knowing something had gone wrong, abuela got panicky. She reached into her brassiere and pulled out the flyer from her coin purse. Chicken, 24 cents, chicken," she began rambling before I had a chance to translate the matter. Chicken, she continued, pointing at the photo of the fryer. Beatrice showed her the fine print that read, "Limit two per customer." But abuela didn't care. "Chicken, 24 cents for chicken, especial," she repeated. Growing impatient, Beatrice reached for the public address mic and paged the manager. "Mr. Quigley, to register 5. Mr. Quigley, register 5, please." I was mortified. Finally becoming aware of the scene she was making, abuela piped down, and I was able to explain the situation. "Qué cabrones. Qué barbaridad," she complained, looking sadly at the 8 chickens left on the conveyor. "Bueno, we'll just take this one and this one," she said. "What about this?" Beatrice asked, holding up the can of easy cheese. "Yes," I yelled, but abuela barked, "I'm not buying anything else here." She paid with exact change and we whisked ourselves away with our two chickens. Esos americanos de mierda and their rules, trying to trick me. This is worse than Cuba, she grumbled, all the way back to the car, slamming the door. ¿Qué pasó?" abuelo asked. Nada, chico. Let's go to la caridad. I'm never coming here again. Pa' la mierda with these beefy people," she shouted as abuelo drove away. So that's Winn-Dixie. So I just wanted to show you a little more slides so you have a visual, maybe when you're reading quietly at home. There's not the last of Winn-Dixie, it's not the last of Easy Cheese. We'll follow little Ricky in the book through a series of adventures. At one time I wanted to call the book, well, thought about calling the book Huckleberry Blanco or Running with Mangoes, so it was great to get an Augustine Burroughs. I think that's what cinched him on giving me the blurb. But it's this sort of Ricky looking for his sort of mythical America, and all the chapters are also sort of organized around a particular relationship that I think, playing off that proverb, of course, that it takes a village, and it does. And so one of that chapter in particular is my grandmother. Focuses on my relationship with my grandmother. But there's other characters. My mother, which I just want you to notice her bag, which is a lightweight version of her 40-pound por si las moscas bag, an idiom meaning in case of the flies, which meant, you know, to be prepared for everything, for the worst, like plagues of flies in case they come. So she had everything in there from toilet paper to mosquito repellent, to Band-Aids, to, in fact, she packed a little pistol on our first trip to Disney World in Chapter 4, in case a band of crazy Americanos would attack us north of the Dade County line. But what I realized, and this is a photo of her in the picture, what I realized in writing the memoir is that her response, that psychological response was of control, was this tender sense of, she had so much loss, she left her entire family in Cuba. The woman had lost a lot of things. I mean, and I think that was that she tried to stabilize her world by controlling as much as she could, but inside she's falling apart. My dad, and there's three characters in here, me in my favorite Mickey Mouse shirt, my father, and El Malibu, the Malibu, which is my dad's, which takes on mythic proportions in the book, like my mother's bag. It was my father's first brand new car, you know, symbol of the American dream. And my dad in the book is, of course, sort of a quintessentially, or maybe typical man of his generation, a quiet man who a little bit emotionally handicapped, but, you know, little moments of great sort of connection that were meaningful. There's my brother, Caco, who's 6.5 years older, which I think is statistically the worst number of years to have children apart, and so he's my arch enemy. He's my superhero. He's my babysitter. He's everything to me in the book, and I'm also a little bit of a devil. And why I show this picture is like, as the baby of the family, I got away with murder, but I always get my mother to dress us alike just to bug him. There's my cat, who's another character, which I just put in there because my grandmother was very homophobic, and of course cats were gay, as well as Fruit Loops and Cub Scouts, and everything was gay, and if it was American, it was even gayer, you know. So I just put the cat sort of follows me throughout the book just to sort of, I hope my grandmother has a laugh with that, where if the pages aren't burning where she's reading it. and then... the other thing that's a character that I really wanted to work into the book was Miami as a character. You know, the Miami, the South Beach of today, of course, is not my Miami, just like the Miami of Yetta, which is in Chapter 5, I think, this elderly Jewish woman that I befriend and have sort of a Harold and Maude kind of relationship, and she teaches me about her Miami Beach long before my family came here. But the idea of that we're blips in the history of these, or there's a larger arc of history of what's going on in time and place and home, and that those questions sort of are constantly revolving around us. And so, oh, that's a little cut off, but that's a couple of me and some old shots of that old Miami Beach, and that... that's known as the Miss America pageant photo in my family. And what else I got? This is a Cocuyo. I don't think I need to explain that to many of you, but it's kind of a firefly, except the eyes light up instead of its little butt. And it's the same magic. They're from the tropics and subtropics in Miami. There used to be a lot of them before Miami turned into a megalopolis. And the same idea of trapped them in the jars with my father, but it's also the name of my grand uncle's store, where I started working when I was 12 years old. So the book, there's this current of little Ricky trying to find his mythic America, but the countercurrent, what happens along the way, as I like to say, he learns about being Cuban. And I don't know that one of the pieces of the story I always wanted to tell was that we don't grow up, at least in my case, and I know my generation and most of my peers, we don't grow up like, oh, I love being Cuban and I just love eating pork on Thanksgiving. You know, we fall in love with our culture slowly as we learn more about it and we mature into it. And that mostly happens at a Cocuyito, which is the name of the store where I started working. And all the characters, all the customers, the employees, the other family members that met there were have significant relationships with, including the very first gay man, Victor, that I actually meet, who becomes sort of a mentor. And we have a relationship, a platonic relationship, but it's like the first sort of contact that I have that breaks out of my sense of what being gay is about. And just a couple other characters, my tia Gloria, who is also an oddball, who's not like your little Cuban princess, and as I wasn't your little Cuban macho, and so we end up having a great relationship and a mentorship. I just love this picture compared to the Winn-Dixie where they just hold a slab of meat up to you, like, you like this one? And then they slice it up. La Cafeteria, where I got addicted to coffee and pastelitos to this day. And of course I get wrapped up. This is one of the cashiers, Sonia, and she looks like she's about to make love to that mango, I mean to that avocado. And I just want to show that to show people from California what a real avocado looks like. And this is her daughter, and I get trapped into, into one of the quinces, and sort of also realizing slowly along the way, culturally, but also the sexuality and all these intersections of things happening, that I was more interested in the dress than what was in the dress. And sort of, so that was another relationship and all the rest. And I'll leave the rest for question and answer, but maybe I'll show a few more slides. But I guess the last thing I sort of wanted to say was what I like about this book, because I think there's three more books before this happens, but it is in a sense, you read it with the sense that it is sort of an American dream story in a way. This little chubby kid who grew up behind a bowling alley in a suburb of Miami and wet-chested, who's having trouble negotiating his sense of place and identity, who's confronting a homophobic grandmother, and all the rest. It's a story for all, in some ways, for all those struggles that make us in the end who we are, and how we can come out the other side, hopefully, shining. And so everything in this book, in some ways, directly led to that, in some ways. It was all there from the beginning. Thank you. Good? We're on time.
Okay, so to follow that act, I finished the book this morning, and while I laughed a lot a couple of days ago as I was reading it, I ended up crying at the end of it. So my questions were done after I finished
the book.
Okay. So one of the things, I mean, sort of journeys is the big, you know, theme here. And obviously this is a book about your journey, right, of becoming a gay poet,
engineer,
right. So this, I was struck by the level of tenderness that you have towards yourself, because that could be very torturous, right, and very conflicting kind of journey, but you were very tender towards yourself, despite your grandmother, who, by the way, looks better in this book than in your poetry.
Right. Yeah, that's an interesting moment too, yeah. Right.
But she, your mother's very tender as well, very protective of you. And I was wondering if there's a relationship between that tenderness that you're allowed to give yourself with words and language.
I think so. I think, you know, even though the book tries to stay, you know, in the psychological moment of what the child is sort of going through, I think you can't help but you're looking back at it as an adult, and you're trying and you do sort of to make sense of your life and not sort of just, you know, crash and burn. You try to sense that tenderness. You're in a way inadvertently trying to make sense of your life, right? You're going back through all these moments and how you make sense, how you find the silver lining in a way, right? Is to see that all those pieces were magical and wonderful and tender. And so while at the moment, you know, and there are some moments in the book of great sort of gravitas, while at the moment you can't see a way out of that, it is interesting about the genre even though I try to stay in the voice of the kid, you're selectively picking out memories that show in the end what really lasted and what really sort of became the whole picture was the tenderness as well as those moments. In the acknowledgments I write, this book allowed me to hate my grandmother, understand her, forgive her, and love her. And in a way, I couldn't just stay in the pain, I couldn't just stay in the verbal abuse. I had to find, in a way, why, like we all do, trying to make sense of our life, and in the end, making sense of that life is a positive sort of take on it, yeah.
So you want to talk a little bit about Victor? I mean, this is a guy who comes from Cuba. You think he's going to be a macho guy. He's not.
Yeah. Victor represents several layers of things. One, he represents another layer of Cuba. He comes during the Mariel boat lift. So he represents another layer of Cuba that isn't my parents' sort of nostalgic vision, someone who grew up after the revolution. And so he informs me about Cuba in one way. He's a mentor that way to find a more balanced story about that place we came from. The other piece about Victor was that I think was one of the hardest things to write about, that you know, coming out is the last step in a series of 1,000 different relationships and little psychological moments that lead up to that moment, and Victor was a key role in that. I was not ready to come out. He knew that. We both knew what we were, in a sense. But he took on more of a mentorship role, and he knew that it wasn't time, and so one of the things I tried to work with Victor's relationship is for us to understand the psychology of the gay child, of the gay teenager. I mean, today we're living in a very different world, but it's not easy. It's still not easy, you know. It's still not easy, and what you go through. And so he's the first person that lets me imagine the possibility of being a gay man, because here's this guy who doesn't fit the stereotype that I grew up with. He's the first real gay man I meet. He's not like, you know, the stereotype of being effeminate. He's not the stereotype of anything that was around me at the time. And so he opens these great doors for me, and he's also an artist. He's a sort of a reluctant artist, and opens that door too, which is part of the memoir. Opens that window too into my possibility of living a life as not only as a gay man, but also as an artist, which growing up in a, you know, working class family, immigrant family, exile family, you know, the arts were, what? You're gonna study what? English? Like, no, that wasn't gonna happen. Even architecture, my grandmother thought was too gay. So there's also the layer of the homophobia against the arts, but also the socioeconomic element of just doing something practical so you can have a better life than we did. And Victor opens up all those doors for me, but in a very selfless moment of love, a real platonic love, he does disappear. I mean, I think he couldn't take it because he knew that it was worse to be around me, because he knew I wasn't ready and might not be ready for another 10 years. And then it took another good 6 years. Yeah. But I found that was a very significant, again, relationship. That whole chapter revolves around Victor.
Right,
yeah.
Right. You're lucky.
Yeah, I was. Right. And again, it's like all these little increments of people that sort of usher you along the way. And I really wanted to tell that story. The book is not a coming out book. I thought it's, to me, what's more exciting is everything that happens to get you there, in a way.
Right. Well, one of the things that the book reminded me of, I don't know how many people have seen Wynton Marsalis's Blood on the Fields, which is a jazz sort of operetta. Where the transatlantic journey of a man and a woman, she was a princess and he was a slave. But by the time they get here, they're in the same boat.
Right.
And for me, the experience of reading your memoir was really understanding how diverse Miami is, how diverse Cuban Miami is. I mean, you have rural people doing their fincas, they've got, you know, people from Havana, you've got different layers of immigrations, but it's all sort of put under, you know, the exile community, the loss, the hatred of what happened in Cuba, this that is sort of from within, and then from without the stereotype, you know,
right,
of the white privileged Cuban exiles or the Miami Mafia.
Right.
And so the book, I think, is to me, one of the most richest testaments of how diverse that community is. If you want to talk a little bit about
it. Yeah, and I think that's why, you know, the big L word, Latino, is so hard to really capture. It can barely capture anything. Because even within our small Cuban community in Miami, there's layers and layers. There were the early, you know, late 1950s, early 60s, a wave of people that had to get out. there was my wave in 1968, which was more of a middle class immigration, and it was political in a way, but it had another sort of more of a quintessential American dream story. Let's go to better life and for all the possibilities of a better life. There's of course the and I wanted to introduce that in the book. There's of course the Mariel wave, which represented this whole other layer of Cubans. And there's a multiplicity of experiences that I think are important for us that I've had to understand. And I did want to make that part of the book. One of the interesting things that's happened to me now is that all my cousins of my generation now live in Miami. When I first went to Cuba, they all lived in Cuba. Now all those cousins live in Miami. And they're negotiating what my parents negotiated, but they're from my generation. And then their kids are negotiating what I negotiate, and they're like, "Oh, mom, that's so tacky! Like, please, I'm not dancing at Kings's, you know." But there's this interesting generational shift, and how within sort of what appears to be this monolithic community, there's all these other layers of experience and of understanding. And I certainly feel blessed to have a balanced view, because as the middle generation, you kind of like, yeah, well, not everybody in Cuba was a millionaire and all this,
right,
you know,
right.
And you also don't buy sort of the very romanticized revolution kind of, and it seems there's that polarized view. And I wanted the book to sort of explore, give everyone a chance to sort of say what their Cuba was.
Right. Well, Raquel, I think, is one.
And Raquel, right.
Is, because I always think Miami is a place where there's so much pain.
Yeah.
And I think that you really, with her.
Yeah, that was one of the characters that I bonded with. She was one of the regulars, almost a groupie of
you call, that's a wonderful phrase. The bodega groupie.
Yeah. She would come like two or three times a day. She lived like across the street. I used to be a little mango, you know, like, and went to get the bread every day for her. And went through her. I mean, she was one of the ones that sort of did suffer a lot as a result of the revolution. And through her, I have a deepening sense of why it is that a certain group of Miami really has this incredible resentment towards the revolution. And it's, you know, it's her husband and is murdered. Like, I mean, forget, you know, ideology aside, that hurts. And so I finally sort of understand, because to me it was all noise, and I was like, what are they all pissed off at this Castro guy for? I don't understand, you know? So that was another sort of perspective in it, because my family didn't have that kind of loss, so my family wasn't so, but then there were others in the community that were, this happened to me and I'm not going. And I think they were all valid experiences, and I think that's what art tries to do, is sort of present the spectrum of what is life, what is an experience, and all that.
So I have one more question before we turn it over to you, and that's about food, okay? I mean, Cocuyo is the name of La Bodega,
right.
All right? So, and everything, I mean, from, I don't think I'm going to get turkey this Thanksgiving.
No. Okay? Let's just give up on that.
So, you know, food for you became both a sense of community as well as where it demarcated you from others, right?
Right. Yeah, and it's funny because it's even, I look back in my poetry and it's just like all over the place. It's a big cultural signifier. It's that comfort food, and it also was so different than you know, anything else outside of that community. And it's still hard to even get Cuban food, even in major metropolitan cities, you know. So just when I land in Miami, the first thing I do is go to like get my Cuban shot of Cuban coffee and my pastelitos and fill up on sugar and fat and hit the road. But it seems to be something I circle back around it. And part of it is the influence of working in the store is what I mean, surrounded by all these foods. And the mystifying of all those foods that I couldn't eat. So it's one of those basic, you know, cultural signifiers that we have, music, food, dance, you know, those kinds of things. And it just, maybe that's part of my obsession too, maybe. I recently got an invitation to read at the national, at the annual conference of the National Food Service Distributors, or Yeah, and I'm super psyched about that. And I got to read at the USDA, and that was a hoot. I mean, I've been waiting 20 years to read it. Do I have food poems for you?
Okay, so questions?
So your book is rooted in particularity. However, it had me, a New Mexican, laughing at times. And I'd argue that it's representative of like a broader sense of Latinidad, and Professor, you can comment on that as well. Characterized by linguistic and religious, so Spanish and Catholicism. Could you comment?
Sure. I mean, I think I've always written from the perspective, maybe because I knew my story wasn't mainstream, I always tried to figure out what about the story is universal. And I was always like to say, like chapter one is like, who has not had a dysfunctional Thanksgiving? Whether you're Cuban or Peruvian or Venezuelan I think the first Thanksgiving was probably very dysfunctional. I mean, come on, you know, probably worse than my house. But trying to tap into the basic sort of common human denominators that we all have, I think that's what art is based on, and it's the irony of how you reach universality is just through specificity. And that's something I always try to strive in my work, in my poetry, and the idea that the art becomes a mirror. It's, yes, I'm telling my story, I'm trying to understand my story, but my ultimate sense of why I write is for that thing to become a mirror, for you to be able to see something about your own life and internalize it and learn something about your place in the world, your relationships, who you are. And within that, one more thing was, yes, like L, you know, the L word is hard to cover, but then on the other flip side of that, there are certain connections that we can't deny, and one of them being that negotiation of a new culture and an old culture and linguistic loyalty. So, you know, a lot of times people who have learned Spanish as a second language, professors that have been colleagues of mine, they want to speak Spanish to me, and like, they speak better Spanish than, they have a better vocabulary than me, and I'm like, this is Spanish for my family, for my community, but I feel weird speaking Spanish because it's a cultural bond as well. It's not just a language.
What inspired you to write the poem for the inaugural? What was your inspiration, and would you read it, please?
I would, if we have time, I'd love to, yeah. Sure. It's great that you would ask that, because in many ways, that poem, if you really read into that poem, it's still that same obsession about home, right? It's about the sense of belonging somewhere. And this is now, sort of in retrospect, in the creative process, you're not even really aware that all this is going into the poem. But it reminded me a lot, I went back to that feeling of community that I grew up with in Miami when exiliados were just going, sitting around going like, what the hell do we do now? And trying to help each other, you know, like you were saying, the doctor, you know, the princess was, and the slave were now in the same, you were all trying to help each other, you were trying to figure it out, and that bonding of community, like a small town feeling, came back to me, and realizing the interconnectedness of all of us. And I sort of just extrapolated, the inspiration was to extrapolate that sense of community and belonging to sort of on a national, sort of a larger nation village, if you will. It's what I wanted to represent. But it had to do a lot with that core sense of belonging and that wish to belong, because the poem does have a little bit of a tension, right? It's not that we're all one today. If you really read it, it's this is who we should be, or this is how, this is the reality of how we're connected, though we don't acknowledge that every day. And so it's waiting for us to name it, waiting for us to map it together. And it's a very strong, because writing that process of that poem, there was still a little part of me that felt as an exile, as an immigrant, well, I'm not quite American. Even when I sat down, even when I got the assignment, and it was touch and go for a while, because you can't write a poem if you're not honest, right? They were still like, well, is this my country? You know, is this, you know, I still thought I had to be Peter Brady or Marsha Brady, you know? You know, I still thought that there was a little part of me, for no particular reason other than just always feeling sort of a little bit of the other, that the poem helped me process. And the greatest gift of the inauguration of that poem was finally feeling that home was in my backyard all along, that my story, my mother's story, everyone's, those 850,000 people, all of their stories has always been a grand part of the American story, and I don't have to be Peter Brady to be American. And so that poem is a wish for everyone to sit around the table, so to speak, but I realized that it was a wish for me to be at that table too, you know.
You know, just I'm going to take a little prerogative here, but I think that's what got Michelle Obama in trouble, right? When she said she felt American when Barack won the presidency. But what is American for you now? I mean, given Miami, given the global world we live in.
Well, I think it's one of, you know, as I said, obsessions. You answer some questions and new questions come along. What I do feel, what I finally accepted was, and it's, I still have a little trouble with it, but that story is American. So let's just begin there. You know, that story of my mother coming over, that story of me growing up and wanting easy cheese, and that is part of a negotiation. America is a young country. And in the same way that sort of the Prince of Cocuyos is a coming of age story, we're still coming of age in America. And what I love that's been happening lately, and of course there's a lot of pushback every time there's a movement, there's always pushback, but people, it seems our country's finally, in a way, coming out of the immigration closet. Even if you watch on TV, like these shows that are becoming very ethnic specific, like Jane the Virgin, Blackish, the Goldbergs, you know, there's this wonderful sort of, I think, and personal experience and people that have been telling me, of course there's a lot of pushback because people get scared, but I'm curious to explore that. And I think still having that, you know, that word, I'm an American, I still, you know, that Brady Bunch grid pops into my head still, but really slowly thinking about that. And I think the next poetry is going to explore that and deepen about that, because it always has been, except we've built a great, wonderful myth around that. But the myth is changing, and I think or the myth is taking on new dimensions. And really from the get-go, you know, it was always a land of others, you know, except for the Native Americans. It was always this, I'm asking the same questions that Whitman was asking me, right, in a way, you know, who are we? And it's beautiful, because what I also learned is that story keeps on getting written, and that we get to participate, thank God, in a democracy on writing that story. Sure, there's chapters we wish we could erase, but they're necessary in some ways. But that story of America doesn't have to end in our lifetime, and it taught me patience. It said, you know what? My selection could not have happened in this country 10 years ago, if you think about that. It just could not have happened as inaugural poet. So maybe I have Pollyanna glasses on all the time, but like, but I have great hope and my renewed sense of hopefully reshaping what that very word means moving forward for real.
I'm curious about Cubans versus the rest of Latin American people. Like, I'm from Colombia. I came as a young adult. But we know home is available. Cubans don't have that choice, at least until now.
Yeah. Still not really.
So how does that relate to Cubans?
I think it relates to your question in a way. And what do we find in common in some ways is negotiation. I mean, and it's generational as well. So I don't know if you have children, but if your children probably go through a different kind of, and your grandchildren go through a different kind of, but what we have in common is always this negotiation of place, right? But that's universal. I mean, you could be born in some ways, I say, you can have an immigrant experience in America and never leave the country and be fourth generation born in Kansas. You move from Miami to Maine, you have an immigrant experience. You move from Maine to San Diego, you move from San Diego to Wichita, Kansas, back. So the negotiation is particularly heightened when we move countries and linguistically when we have to learn new languages. But I think that's one thing we have in common. And then within that, and I think that's the base, sort of like we're always negotiating in some ways our loyalties, our cultural loyalties and identities. But yeah, within each group, and so sometimes I feel at a loss speaking, for example, for Mexican Americans, because the history of that group in America sort of has this whole other history and this whole, you know, hundreds of years of history versus Cubans, you know, from the 50s, and then our unique sort of status as, which I think is what should be for all immigrants, you know, the that Adjustment Act should, right, just be adjusted across the board, so that we have a particular sort of moments that we go through, and one of the key differences is that you can't go back, and part of that is it creates this imaginary place, and it creates a deeper longing in some ways, perhaps, than others, because you always want what you can't have. So if you look at Miami, in some ways, it can become a little bit provincial, because it's the holding on to that. The moment they left, whenever you left, you try to hold on to that memory, because in some ways, there's still a part of you, even me, that I say going back, though I wasn't born there, there's always that little thing you want to take it back exactly the way you brought it. And I've learned to deal with that, and I've learned to have empathy with that. It's more than nostalgia. It's a kind of self-preservation and a fear of assimilating. Yet there's the irony that Cubans could considerably have, in some ways, are also as completely detached from Cuba because they can't go back. So there's no option of, like, it's almost like the older immigration, the kind of feeling like, you got to make it here because we can't go back. I mean, we want to go back. Someday we'll go back. But so there's all these sorts of layers of irony and what seems contradictory. But I love that. I think that's the common thing, is that negotiation. And I think that's universal. We've been having to deal with immigration is not a United States. It's not an issue. I mean, as Ruth Behar says, you know, she told me one day, she's like, Richard, people have been moving around for a long time. We are always constantly searching for home. It's a fundamental drive. It's in our literature. It's in our folk tales. It's in all our traditions of faith, this idea of the Eden, of the Shangri-La, of the Promised Land, of the Avalon, this thing that we're always going back to, or going to find that perfect connection, that perfect home, and all of what that means.
I'm the mother of an English major, and what would your message be to English majors in a world that's really giving a lot of pressure, or I should say a culture that's really pressuring kids now to go into sciences, CS, and business, and walk away from the liberal arts, particularly English?
Yeah, oh, gosh. You hit a hot button issue with me. As an engineer and poet, I'm like the poster child for liberal arts. I think it's interesting that it's an knee-jerk reaction to become more reductionist against the economy, as if, okay, we really got to focus now. You're an engineer. What do you need to read literature for? You're a poet. What do you need to know about algebra for? In that sense, so I think it's always in universities that I've read for the last 18 months and things like that, I always say, even though you don't get a liberal arts degree, you have to have a liberal arts approach to life. If you look at most of the great thinkers, most of the great people that have changed this world is because of synthesis of knowledge, not reducing knowledge, you know, to thin slices. And it's unfortunate, but, you know, it seems to be getting polarized like a lot of things. It's either sort of just liberal arts. And there are schools that are trying to find that right balance, but it seems it's a knee-jerk reaction. I think, you know, as I always like to say, Margaret Thatcher was a chemist, you know. Alfred Hitchcock was an electrical engineer. Where are some of the others? The chief structural engineer for the Golden Bridge was a poet, for the Golden Gate Bridge was a poet. If you really look at what changes is synthesis of knowledge. And I hope we start to realize that. I know I'm trying to do my part by reinfusing and working with teachers to get them excited about teaching poetry and different things to open up and broaden, at least in my capacity, in my genre, to try and do something about that. But I'm with you on that. So
I think we'd like for you to read your poem.
Sure. And what do you know? I just happen to have it right here. I'll read you a very, very short excerpt that was going on psychologically while I'm sitting there on the platform, still revising the poem. In the moment, I feel America standing as one, putting differences aside and taking a deep collective breath. We pay tribute to something far bigger and more important than any one of us, and I truly feel like one of us, one of we, the people, in the echoes of the president's and others' speeches. I embrace America in a way I never had or thought I could, feeling for the first time that I belong, truly belong, to one country. Not an imaginary ideal from TV or a nostalgic island floating in the sea of my parents' memories, but a real, tangible place that is mine, was mine all along. I turn to my mother and whisper, "Mama, I think we're finally Americanos." She gives me a tender look as if saying, "I know. I know." Senator Schumer introduces me and calls me up to the podium. My mother squeezes my shoulder. I stand more confident than I imagined I would or could be, transfixed by the moment that is no longer about me or my poem or my glory, but about our country. Still, I'm surprised when the president and vice president stand up to greet me and shake my hand on the way to the podium. They both whisper something in my ear that I can't make out, but their gracious gestures speak silently to my heart, silently, as if saying, "Richard, here is your country. This is your story. Here, your home." I step up to the podium, look out over the crowd, a patchwork quilt of lives, of stories spread across our ground, under our sky, beneath our one sun. I take it all in as I take one deep breath and then another. This is for them. This is for us. For all of us, I think to myself, and begin speaking into our wind. "Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, America won today. One sun rose on us today, kindled over our shores, peeking over the Smokies, greeting the faces of the Great Lakes, spreading a simple truth across the Great Plains, then charging over the Rockies. One light waking up rooftops. Under each one, a story told by our silent gestures moving behind windows. My face, your face, millions of faces in morning's mirrors, each one yawning to life, crescendoing into our day. Pencil yellow school buses, the rhythm of traffic lights, fruit stands, apples, limes, and oranges arrayed like rainbows, begging our praise. Silver trucks heavy with oil or paper, bricks or milk, teeming over highways alongside us, on our way to clean tables, read ledgers, or save lives, to teach geometry or ring up groceries, as my mother did for 20 years, so I could write this poem for us today. All of us. As vital as one light we move through. The same light on blackboards with lessons for the day, equations to solve, history to question, or atoms imagined. The I have a dream we keep dreaming, or the impossible vocabulary of sorrow that won't explain the empty deaths of 20 children marked absent today and forever. Many prayers. But one light, breathing color into stained glass windows, life into the faces of bronze statues, warmth onto the steps of our museums and park benches as mothers watch their children slide into the day. One ground, our ground, rooting us to every stalk of corn, every head of wheat sown by sweat and hands gleaning coal or planting windmills in deserts and hilltops that keep us warm, hands digging trenches, hands routing pipes and cables, hands as worn as my father's, cutting sugarcane so my brother and I could have books and shoes. The dust of our farms and deserts, our cities and plains, mingled by one wind, our breath. Breathe. Hear it through the day's gorgeous din of honking cabs, buses launching down avenues, the symphony of footsteps, guitars, and screeching subways, the unexpected songbird on your clothesline. Hear squeaky playground swings, trains whistling or whispers across cafe tables. Hear the doors we open for each other all day, saying hello, shalom, buongiorno, howdy, namaste, or buenos dias. In the language my mother taught me, in every language spoken into one wind carrying our lives without prejudice, as these words break from my lips. One sky, since the Appalachians and Sierras claimed their majesty, and the Mississippi and Colorado worked their way to the sea, thank the work of our hands, weaving steel into bridges, finishing one more report for the boss on time, stitching another wound or uniform, the first brushstroke on a portrait or the last floor on the Freedom Tower jutting into a sky that yields to our resilience, one sky toward which we sometimes lift our eyes, tired from work, some days guessing at the weather of our lives, some days giving thanks for a love that loves you back. Sometimes praising a mother who knew how to give or forgiving a father who couldn't give what you wanted. And so we head home. Home. Through the gloss of rain or weight of snow or the plum blush of dusk, but always, always home, always under one sky, our sky, and always one moon, like a silent drum tapping on every rooftop and every window of one country, all of us facing stars and hope, a new constellation, waiting for us to map it, waiting for us to name it, together. Thank you. Okay. Our microphones are mating. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.